Lena 2 thematic review, networks of exchange circa 1200 to 1450. Just a reminder about our six themes, since this is a thematic review, we're going to use these six themes as our organizing principle for this video. And our essential question for the unit asks for similarities and differences among the various networks of exchange. So it's a pretty straightforward comparison question about these trade networks. And a reminder about what those are. In this unit, we had the Silk Roads, the Indian Ocean, and the Trans-Saharan. Those three are going to be the three main ones we will compare. And some parallel developments that are significant are the Mongol Empire, and then cultural and environmental effects of these trade networks. So we'll start with the social theme, which remember is about group norms. And we're going to look at class structures and the fact that trade networks during this time period solidified class structures by forcing lower classes to work more to meet the rising demand. So examples of then China were the proto-industrialization in which steel was made in homes and textiles like silk, which were produced by lower classes. In India, we had farmers producing cotton for sale along the Indian Ocean trade routes. And in Southeast Asia, we had spices that were cultivated by the lower classes. We also have the slave trade as a continuity from previous centuries. And this map here shows the slave trade in Eastern Africa, both along the Indian Ocean and overland towards the Mediterranean. So this is a good time to stop and review by identifying and explaining how trade networks reinforced social structures. And this is a good format for your answer. Okay, our first political development will be about the Mongols, who created the largest land empire in world history shown here. And the way they did that was by using superior military tactics, such as cavalry, soldiers, and adopting technologies that they encountered. And as far as the trade networks go, the relevant thing is that this large empire helped to facilitate trade because there was some unity along the Silk Road's trade route with it being governed by one empire. So we do have some new states as a result of the Mongol conquest. The green here is the Yuan dynasty in China, and the Mongols adopted some of the Chinese political systems like their bureaucratic system. In purple here, we had the Ilkhanate of Persia, and you might remember that its leaders converted to Islam. We also had in yellow on this map the Khanate of the Golden Horde, which is Mongol conquest of Russia. And again, the really relevant point for this particular unit is the fact that they helped to facilitate trade, particularly over land in the Silk Roads area. Next, we'll look at the way the trade networks helped foster the growth of states in this era. And the way they do that is by providing revenue to support the functions of government. So some examples of states that benefited from trade is along the Silk Roads, the Song Dynasty over here in China, and of course the Mongol Empire shown in orange here. For the Indian Ocean trade, we had the Swahili city-states down the east coast of Africa. We had Gujarat, which was in India, and we have the Malacca Sultanate, which controlled access to East Asia through the Strait of Malacca. And then some examples of states that benefited from the Trans-Saharan trade network, which remember comes from the Mediterranean over here. We had Ghana in an earlier century from Unit 1, and then in this time we have Mali, and then the Songhai Empire, which expands towards the east. We also have some cities that are important in facilitating trade, and some of them rise and fall during this time period. Examples of cities that are strong are Hangzhou, which was a trading city in China, and Samarkand, which was a city along the Silk Roads trade network, and Kashgar, another city, and then Constantinople are declining during this time period. Constantinople is here in the Byzantine Empire, and it was conquered by Islamic forces right towards the end of this time period. So now we can stop and explain how trade networks fostered the growth of states. And it's kind of a symbiotic relationship. Remember that the trade provides the money for the state, and that is kind of one direction, and the states also support the trade and facilitate it and help make it more profitable. Next, we'll look at the environmental theme, and we'll start with some positive environmental effects of these trade networks. And generally, that's because humans are able to increase trade or make more food available in the way that they manage the environment. So in the Mongol Empire, for instance, they invested in infrastructure that would be helpful to trade, such as building bridges and roads. And so that transportation technology made trade increase in volume. Another big development that helps with the food availability is the diffusion of crops. As trade expands, it exposes people to new crops and helps spread their cultivation and make more food available. And a good example of that is champa rice, which was introduced to China from Vietnam. And it's one of the factors of this population growth in the Song Dynasty. Champa rice was introduced right around this time period. You can see a big increase, and it's not only because of the rice, but it did, in some cases, double food production in areas of China that adopted it. We also have crops like like bananas and sugar and citrus, which were introduced from Southeast Asia, from this general area, and they diffused towards Africa. For instance, bananas were introduced to sub-Saharan Africa here. They find their way along Indian Ocean trade routes to the Islamic world, and generally they were introduced after that to Europe, and from Europe in a future unit, we'll see that they were introduced to the Americas. On the negative side, we have humans managing the environment poorly. In other words, it's the fault of people. And we also have uncontrollable effects that limit population. An example of poor management is soil erosion caused by overgrazing. And that happened in Great Zimbabwe down here in Eastern Africa. We also had deforestation in which trees were cut down to make room for crops. And the problem is the topsoil tends to get washed away by big storms. The main uncontrollable effect is the diffusion of pathogens like the plague. So this graph here shows the likely source of plague in China in the 14th century. And you can see the arrow here showing the diffusion of the plague mirrors the Silk Road's trade network, which is right about here. We also think the plague was introduced along the Indian Ocean trade route, and you can see it beginning to diffuse along the Trans-Saharan trade route. So what happens is, as these trade networks bring populations of people together, there are people with no immunity to existing diseases, and the effects can be quite devastating, such as the Black Death in Europe. So now we can stop and focus on the positive and negative effects of trade networks around the world from an environmental standpoint. For our first cultural development, we'll look at the fact that trade networks tend to facilitate the spread of religion. And Buddhism is a good example of that, which from its starting point here in India spread over land along the Silk Road's trade networks and by sea along the Indian Ocean trade networks to places like China and Southeast Asia. And from China, it spread to other places like Japan, where it was combined with some traditions to make Zen Buddhism, which is a good example of syncretism. Zen Buddhism combines Taoism and Buddhism. And another idea we had from China is the idea of Neo-Confucianism and the spreading of the influence of Confucianism in China's trade connections under the tribute system with its neighbors. Hinduism also spread from India, primarily to Southeast Asia, to states like Srivijaya and the Khmer empires shown here. This is Khmer and this is Srivijaya. And Islam is probably the main religion spread. If you see this map, it's quite extensive. Muhammad had been a merchant himself before becoming the founder of a religion, and so Islam was very trade-friendly. So you can see from its starting point here on the Arabian Peninsula, it spreads also along the Silk Road's trade network, along the Indian Ocean trade networks, both the Southeast Asia and East Africa, and along the Trans-Saharan trade networks to states like Mali in West Africa. And in general, a factor of the diffusion of trade, especially over land, was the Mongols and their religious tolerance. So inside the Mongol Empire, remember, which was kind of up here in Central Asia, there was a lot of religious tolerance, and that facilitated the spread of religions because people were welcome to practice their own particular religion. Our next development is the exchange of cultures more generally. And under the Mongol Empire, the uniting of the Silk Roads and this kind of tan area here helped to exchange cultural developments such as paper from China, medicine from the Arab world, and the idea of Arabic numerals from India. They were invented in India and introduced by Islamic traders to Europe. And so these goods are all getting towards Europe during this time period, largely because of these trade networks. Another development is the creation of what we call diasporic communities. A diaspora is a group of people who leave their homeland and settle together in a new place. So these are communities of merchants, and some examples of that were Arab from here and Persian from here, traders who settled down here in East Africa, and that's how Islam is introduced to places like the Swahili city-states. We had Chinese traders settling in Southeast Asia, and we had Malay traders coming from Malaysia settling throughout the Indian Ocean basin. Another example of this later in our time period in the Ming Dynasty in China was the voyages of Zheng He, who was an admiral who was sent by the Ming Dynasty to explore the Indian Ocean basin, and he explored pretty much everywhere in Indian Ocean shown on this map. He made it all the way here to East Africa. And some examples of what he did, he was a Muslim and he built mosques in many places that he visited. He also brought back exotic animals to the emperor's court. So we can stop and talk about how trade networks fostered the exchange of culture. And we looked at religions and also some technologies such as paper. Next, we'll look at economic developments, and the first is the fact that what really drives the expansion of these trade networks is increased demand for goods. So some examples of that for the Silk Roads are mostly goods from China, which is the kind of economic powerhouse at this time period. So silk, porcelain, steel, gunpowder are all examples of goods from China that are in high demand and traded through the Silk Roads, especially during the Mongol Empire. And with the fact that unity in the empire making it easy to trade goods long distances further increases demand. On the Indian Ocean, some examples of goods on demand are cotton and pepper from India, spices from Southeast Asia, slaves and gold from East Africa, and figs and horses from Southwest Asia. And then the Trans-Saharan trade networks here are designed to access goods like gold and slaves from those West African empires like Mali and Songhai. And next we'll look at the fact that some of this trade is dependent upon commercial innovations, which are ways to do business. And one is providing places to trade. So along the Silk Road's trade networks, there were these caravanserai, places where caravans could stop and resupply and rest. A similar idea along the Trans-Saharan trade network are oases, towns that have water where you can stop and replenish. And then we had those larger cities along the Silk Road's trade network, like Kashgar and Samarkand. We also had cities like Calicut in India and the Swahili city-states for the Indian Ocean trade. And Timbuktu right here was a major trading city for the Trans-Saharan trade network. Another development is making it easier to do business. And these financial innovations, like flying cash and the bill of exchange, which are especially used on the Silk Road's trade network, help to ease trade between diverse people. As these trade networks get bigger and bigger, and you have people from different cultures or countries coming into contact with each other, we have the beginnings of a banking industry and the fact that people can exchange notes instead of cash, which makes the travel more secure and also helps to prevent the need for exchanging currency. So we can stop and look at how these economic developments caused the expansion of trade networks. And lastly, we'll look at technology, and starting with transportation technology. So along the Silk Roads, we had the camel saddle and caravans. We have the same thing on the Trans-Saharan trade network. So much of the territory crossed by the Silk Roads, especially right here, is desert. And of course, the Trans-Saharan is crossing the Sahara Desert. The camel saddle makes it possible to carry more goods on the backs of these camels, and the caravans make the volume even higher. On the Indian Ocean, we have maritime technology like the compass and astrolabe. We also have the lateen sail, which is shown here, and the dhow and the rudder, which make navigation more efficient in terms of being able to go directly where you want to go. And it also makes the volume greater because some of these ships, like the dhow, become larger and larger. So all of these things help to increase the volume and the distance of trade, which of course will allow it to expand. And lastly, we'll look at the diffusion of technology, which was dependent upon these trade networks. So gunpowder, for instance, which was developed in China, was introduced to much of Asia along Silk Road's trade, and especially under the Mongols. And we think it's possible that the Mongols introduced gunpowder to Europe. The Mongols also adopted the cannon and siege engines, which they use in their conquests. And in conquering people, they exposed new people to those technologies. And we also have the invention of paper in China, which was introduced to Europe along these trade networks. So now we can stop and look at technology and how those developments caused the expansion of trade networks. So here's a timeline to remind you of some key events during this time period. And you could also review Unit 2 by looking at a chronology instead of a thematic organization. So if you remember, our essential question was a comparison asking about similarities and differences. So one good way to do this is if you have common processes like innovations in trade, those would be a good fit for similarities, and less common processes would be a good fit for differences. So some of the similarities we could talk about would be the technological innovations, the way that trade networks support the building of states, the diffusion of culture along trade networks, and the fact that they expanded largely because of the increased demand for goods. And less common, for instance, is really only under the Silk Roads that we have this political unity. Hinduism is one of the least common cultural traditions to be spread, and these negative environmental impacts were not as common either. And these letters, of course, represent those different themes, political, cultural, economic, etc. If you were answering this question, you would be comparing these trade networks. So you might have a similarity that says in both the Indian Ocean and Trans-Saharan, religions were diffused. And then you might have a difference that says in the Silk Roads, there was unity, while in the Indian Ocean, there were lots of different states or something like that. But this comparison is a good way to look at these developments from a conceptual standpoint and use specific pieces of information to help support your analysis. That's your Unit 2 thematic overview. Happy studying!